If I can make an impression on one, just one of you kids that's here, that's really all I want. Because if somebody somewhere had made an impression on me, maybe I wouldn't have done it.
This is Florrie Fisher's story, told in her own words to a group of New York City high school students, typical of teenagers across the country.
But I'm very
it's not a pretty story.
This group here,
it's a story of heartbreak and hell.
That I would like
it's a story of 23 wasted years in the life of a drug addict. 17 of those years behind bars. It's a true story.
Silverman said something wrong. He said I was a drug addict. Well, I was not a drug addict. I am a drug addict. I haven't used anything in over 4 years, but I never forget that I am a drug addict. And I want to thank you very, very much for letting me talk to you, because this is my lifeline. I have to talk about it every day. You know, I'll be very honest with you. I never have days that I'm just completely like everybody else. Every time my mother aggravates me, and she's 80 years old and my dad's 89, and God bless him, they aggravate the hell out of me. You know, I say, oh, I wish I could get high. But it's a feeling that I have inside. Gut level, I'd like to be high. I'm not going to lie to you. It's a great feeling. You smoke marijuana and it's great. You go further than that, it's even greater. Gut level, I like that feeling. But intellectually, I now know that I can't smoke one stick of pot. I can't take one snort of horse. I can't take one needle of cocaine, because I am an addictive personality. And that's all I need, is one of anything. You know, I need one dress. If I happen to like this dress in tan, I buy the same dress in green and black and pink. This is the type of personality I am.
Someday a friend may offer you a trip to a world of colors you can taste and music you can see. A world where minutes take hours to tick by. This is the mind-bending world of
Mondo Diablo. Hello again, and welcome to yet another Please regard this article from the oft-used Wikipedia. After an interview with David Susskind generated 100,000 letters, Susskind invited Fisher to appear on the Mike Douglas Show while Susskind co-hosted with Douglas in 1969. Fisher then began speaking at schools and wrote an autobiography, The Lonely Trip Back, which told of her life from childhood up to the point when she became a motivational speaker. In 1970, she appeared in The Trip Back, a public service announcement recording of her appearance at a New York high school. During her time as a motivational speaker, Fisher was affiliated with the rehabilitation movement Synanon, which she credited with helping her beat her addiction. She also had ties to Phoenix House, a sister organization of Synanon's, and often recommended it to students during her speeches as a reliable means of combating addictions. According to an epilogue appended to the Mike Douglas transcript in the Rotarian, Florrie Fisher died in Miami, Florida in 1972 from liver cancer, kidney failure, and cardiac arrest. This next article is from jerryblank.com. One of the primary inspirations for the plight of Jerry Blank was a 28-minute 1970 documentary produced by the New York Daily News called The Trip Back, which featured a 50-year-old former junkie prostitute named Florrie Fisher lecturing a group of high school students about the perils of drug use. Any resemblance between Florrie Fisher and Jerry Blank from Strangers with Candy is purely intentional. In fact, a number of Jerry's best lines were lifted almost verbatim from Florrie's ranting diatribe. See it for yourself. After Amy Sedaris, Paul Dinello, and Stephen Colbert saw The Trip Back, they decided to tell Florrie's tale with a twist. Instead of being a former user, boozer, and loser who visits high schools to help young people to make the right decisions, their protagonist would return to high school as a student and would still make all the same old mistakes, but now she'd make them the right way. Amy was also influenced by a book from the early 1980s, Is There No Place on Earth for Me, by Susan Sheehan, and partly based Jerry's background on that book's subject, a schizophrenic who is referred to by the alias Sylvia Frumkin.
Well, well, dear, here we are in the woods, all set for a nice long vacation. Just you and I. No one else around, no telephones, no newspapers, no radio, no nothing.
What will we do for amusement?
Naive, aren't you?
Well, if we're going to camp here, I suppose we'd better get the stuff out of the car.
Yeah, you just relax while I get it out.
I'll be happy to help you get it out.
Don't be so anxious. I can get it out by myself. You can help afterwards.
My, it certainly is peaceful here in the woods. That's what I like.
Yes, yes, I like a little peace now and then myself.
It's nice that we can enjoy the peace together.
Well, I don't think I could enjoy it without you. Well, I'd better get to work on this tent. It isn't always easy to erect it.
Maybe I can help you get it up.
Oh, let me fool around with it myself first. I think I can get it up all right. Then you can help.
Okay, but be sure you get it up right. I'd hate to have a fold up on me.
Well, if I have any trouble making it stand up, I'll let you know.
Oh, I'll watch you, and I'll be able to see if you can't do it.
Yes, well, that'll be fine. Say, maybe you'd better give me a hand with it. Just grab hold of that end and pull on it.
Looks heavy. I better grab it with both hands.
Be careful not to pull too hard, though. I don't want you to damage it. I think that's stretched out far enough now. Just lay it on the ground for a minute.
Won't it get dirty?
Well, if it does, you can sweep it off with your broom. Now, let's see. Where's that hole I'm supposed to stick this pole into?
You mean this one?
No. The one next to it. That hole looks too worn and frayed. It's been used too much. Say, this hole is too small for my pole.
It is kind of a tight fit. But I think if we both push hard, we can get it in. Maybe if you had a little piece cut off the end, it would help.
Yes, I had a piece cut off the end a long time ago.
Oops, there it went in. I wonder if it'll be just as hard coming out.
I doubt it.
Now what are you going to do?
Oh, I'm hungry. Let's just leave things where they are while I find something to chew on.
Well, I've got a pair you can nibble on while we're doing this.
Well, that'll be fine. You know, I'd enjoy that. Say, but how about you? Don't you want to eat something?
After we get through with this, I'll eat it.
Okay, you'd better let me do all the work. If we're going to hole up here for a couple of weeks, you're liable to get pretty tired.
Oh, I don't think so. You probably get tired out before I do. As a matter of fact, I'll make a bet with you that you do.
So you want a bet, huh? All right, that's a good idea. Now, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'm going to lay you 10-1.
You lay me 10-1?
That's what I said. I'll lay you 10-1.
Well, but tell me something.
What?
What will we do after one?
How would you like to turn on your radio tomorrow morning and hear this?
People of America, you are free. Your oppressors have been The People's Committee has asked me to give you a report on the glorious victories in this newly liberated country. No longer do you need to worry that your news is being distorted by those capitalists that formerly ran the old warmongering establishment and their lackeys. Several great heroes of our victorious revolution sit with me now in the studio. Comrade Hokey Carlyle, Hap Crown, Angela Mavis, Mrs. Albecker, and many others. Many students and revolutionaries are gathering with me back in this liberated land from the republics of Cuba, China, and the Soviet Union. Hail to the heroes! Greetings also to our great new leader in Washington, Chairman Gus Ball. Now, the committee has asked me to tell you why there's no electricity, water, gas, or telephones working in your homes. Now, the plants for these were successfully bombed by our special corps at a moment's notice after the revolutionary signal was given. The workers' team will commence the reconstruction and repair of your utilities next week. Meanwhile, stay in your houses. Don't bother to change your dial or your television channel. The committee has arranged so that this is the only program coming forth over every station. The state wants to ensure you get the absolute truth. Now, we have more good news. We have successfully eliminated the old fascist warmongering governor of this state. Your morning newspaper now carries a new people's masthead. The Daily Worker Times. Long live Fidel Castro. Long live Walter Ulbricht. We salute the spirit of comrades Marx, and Lenin. Hail to the victors. Hail to the workers. Some have asked if there's any more resistance still left in this country. Well, there are only little pockets of resistance from the fanatical Christians in such places as Phoenix, and Pittsburgh, Norfolk, Tulsa, and Glendale. But we shall crush these pockets of the deceivers of the people, those fanatical reactionary Christians, before this day is out. The people's government will not tolerate any meeting whatsoever in that place of reactionary resistance, the church buildings of this country. And there shall be no home meetings anywhere. Every Bible store carrying that Christian propaganda has already been burned by our special forces, according to the great master plan of liberation. The people, students, and the elite army of the revolution successfully took within 2 days of our signal every police station, armory, and military base in this country. The Pentagon is now fully under the control of our new leader, Chairman Ball, in Washington. Our fear and confusion paralyzed this entire land that we might be able to gloriously and swiftly liberate it in this one great stroke from within. The establishment is dead. Long live the People's Government of America. All banks and business now belongs to the state. All houses and lands now belong to the people's state. Your old American dollars are, as of today, declared void and dead. The new people's dollars are now the coin of the liberated state. Each man, woman, and child will now receive free 1,000 new people's dollars as you are registered at the City Hall this week. Tomorrow, all those whose last name begins with A, B, C, and D are to come to the City Hall to receive your free state money. Now, when you pick up your free money, you'll receive a beautiful stamp of our international peace symbol, the inverted cross, and your own serial number on your hand. You must hereafter show this mark to spend your people's money and to receive your free government service. Now, isn't this glorious news? Peace is here at last in the land. Keep tuned for more good news from our new leaders. Long live our new chairman in liberated Washington.
The world is full of it. Now, I know you kids, in order to have the ends justify the means, have read, have talked, have heard, marijuana is not addictive. Well, that's true. Marijuana is not addictive. The doctors are telling you the truth. Marijuana is not physically addictive, but it is so psychologically addictive that you cannot. And before I go any further, I'll tell you, people say, give me statistics. The hell with statistics. I don't want a piece of paper with numbers on it. I am unto myself a statistic, the only statistic I need, along with me, 23 years of living with nothing but gutter hypes and junkies. I have thousands of friends, if you will. They're all junkies, and there isn't one, not one, who didn't start smoking marijuana. Now, I talk to kids, and they say, well, Miss Fisher, your talk is not pertinent to me because my culture is just smoking marijuana. Well, you know what? My culture just smoked marijuana until we got on horse. And, you know, you're young. You know, you're beautiful with young youth. And along with young youth comes a curiosity of young youth. And if you smoke a stick of pot and you feel good, who here can tell me that if somebody says, man, that was a gas, you ain't lived until you took a snort of horse. Don't you want to try it? You know it can't happen to you. You're not going to get hooked with one shot, and you're not going to get hooked with one shot. And you over there with the beads on, you're not going to get hooked with one shot. But it only takes one shot to take a second shot, and that second shot goes into a third, and then you get like me. You start needing $185 a day. And you know what? The bank presidents don't have that kind of money at their command. So now, here I am. I'm a girl from a nice middle to upper class Jewish family. I have a sister and brother who are the pillars of society. I'm the baby. I was very much loved by my parents. I won't go into it now, but I blame my mother and father for loving me too much.
Now said it must have happened before the sun came up. Me and Mama was sleeping, never heard a sound. How they got in, we'll never know. They never left a trace, not a fingerprint or footprint in the new fallen snow. To get upstairs, they had to pass my room and all the guns on the wall. To find their way in the dark, they must have been here before. His billfold was full of money, his gold watch and his chain. We're lying out in the open, but it wasn't what they came here to take. Someone broke in our house last night. The doors and the windows were all locked up tight. And a thief never thinks of the pain. Mama and me. When the angels broke in our house last night and took Daddy away, the angels broke in our house last night and took Daddy away.
From the time I could talk, I was a pathological liar. And all of this was a lead-up into my addictive personality. Now, I was in the country, in the Jewish Catskills, and I met a, what you call a hippie now, was a zoot zooter then, you know, the whole bit with the peg pants, the long jacket, and the swinging keychain, the mustache, and the sideburn. And I thought he was just gorgeous. And I conned my mother into going home and letting me stay at a girlfriend whose parents had their own little place in the mountains. So I spent the weekend with this guy, and he was smoking marijuana. And I thought he was just so marvelous. Anything he wanted to do, I wanted to identify with him, and I did it. Never heard of marijuana before. And incidentally, you school kids, don't think, well, education. You know, I'm a college graduate. It doesn't matter. Drugs, marijuana, arose by any other name. Well, drug is the most negative working thing that I have ever met. It sucks every part of you up in a negative way. Now, you all sit complacently. It can happen to you. It can and it will. You girls, you Negroes, I don't know whether you live in Harlem, but I know a Harlem that you kids don't know. You know, I know a Harlem where I laid on Dope Street. I'm sure it's still Dope Street, 117th Street. I know the sports bar is closed. I know all these places. I copped there. All the cocaine, all the caps, all the $25 half loads and the $50 bundles. I copped from everybody. And there I was, sleeping in a bathroom, nodding out where any man could make me his prey. And you know what? It wouldn't make any difference, because I didn't know. I was zonked. I didn't have to do this. This is something drugs led me to. Now, I married a man, this boy. You know, he smoked marijuana. This was his only crime. He was a young kid. He had 2 years of college. And you know what I did? I made a pimp out of him, an 18-carat pimp.
Yeah. against impossible odds and deceptive facades. One group outshines, man, just look at the signs. See, we winning all over the place, giving solutions to the world and the whole human race. We ain't never gonna back down, leave town, play the clown. Psychiatry and the speech, you know we take him down. See, the purpose in green is burning in our blood. They the passing storm, we the unstoppable flood. See, cause we the IAS and we're dauntless and defiant. We confront even the giants, yo. Handle anyone but freedom for all. Cause you know when we win, then nobody falls. So bring it harder, y'all. You know we got it in us, y'all. Let's make it stronger now. Unite as one. That's what the call. Come on, and we'll forever be the winners. Scientology ads and the PSAs. Let's play them 24-7, watch them clear the haze. We're lighting the path, the man has sought so long. Now the search is over, the truth is out, the mystery's gone. See, that's why I say there's no letting up. To all the people are free, you know what's up to us. With Narcanon and Criminon, apply Scholastics. New AOs in the cons, yo, it's truly fantastic. Cause there ain't no limit to what we can do. So I wanna see you up, just vanish here, yeah, you and you and you. So many lives to the cavalcade, spreading the help. So see, by creating more, the dwindling spiral, we're turning it around. We got the greatest campaigns this world has ever had. So keep the force going, you know we'll never rest. Cause as a matter of course, we be the very best. So stand proud, shout it loud, we the IAS.
The same power is in us that raised Christ Jesus from the dead. Mm-hmm. I see someone, you literally have had a child that just died. And I speak to the spirit of death in that child in the name of Jesus, and I command you to leave that child. I speak to the spirit of infirmity that caused the child's death, and I say, live in Jesus' name. Live! And I see a child coughing, waking up. Oh, we saw that in Pakistan. We saw a little boy raised from the dead just like that. Yeah. God
and
is
healed.
On the move.
Not only raised from
God
the dead,
God is on the move.
I was a call girl. I was young. I was fly. I was pretty. And I was out selling my body. Kept going to jail. And, you know, 10 years later, I had to be $10 cheaper, and I wasn't a call girl. I became a madam. Then I became a street whore. Then I've been in every department store. My mug is in every post office. It isn't now, thank God, but it was. But there was no place that I could go, and I kept going to jail. I was busted 3 months after I got my first habit, and I was sentenced to 1 to 3 years, that's pen and death, in the House of Detention in Greenwich Village. I'm sure you all know where it was. And I spent 24 months there on my first offense for possession of a needle. I came out, and what do? You know, you're hooked. Psychologically, you're hooked. You're in jail. You're out jail. You're using. If you're not, you're thinking of how quickly you can use and when. You know, every day that I spent in jail, I dreamt about the time I could cook my breakfast up in a teaspoon. And I'm sure every one of you have been exposed to that type of talk. This is a shot of heroin. Now, I came out of jail. I went back to jail. I came out of jail. I went back to jail. I've done 4 years, 5 years. In the House of Detention, I have 12 years racked up in 30 days, in 90 days, in a year, in 3 years. I have 4 years in Bedford. I was in Rayford, and I did a year. I came out, and in 1955, I got married, October 16th. And on my honeymoon, 2 days later, in Key West, I was busted. And I went to jail for 4 years. Well, in all that time, my husband and I, the only lovemaking we ever did was our letter once a week where we swore undying love. You know, I haven't seen my husband. I came out, he met me, and it kind of dissipated itself. It's not important. But the thing is, there was my life. And you know something? I know that every one of you kids feel great. You know, she's 50 years old. How does she identify with you?
Should be our only quest. I've known David for many, many years. David has played a critical role in almost everything that I have done in the last few years. He has been by my side, and he is a wise and generous counsel. He is gentle, kind, and humble, and most importantly, honest. I have never seen David close-minded. I've never seen him close-minded to people or opinions or conclusions contrary to his own. He is a seeker and a searcher. I have never seen him unwilling to learn something new. I have never seen him insist that he is right when the facts demonstrate otherwise. If there is a selfish bone in his body, let me tell you, he is the best at hiding that. I believe David Barton is one of the most important voices, if not the most important voice in America today. He is a selfless servant, which makes him so powerful and, quite frankly, so frightening to so many.
I do identify with you. You know why? I'm a 50-year-old hippie. I think exactly like you think. The only thing is you think it, and I have thought it, done it, acted upon it, and suffered by it. Now, you know, you can be smart. The only thing is, I wasn't smart with dope. I couldn't handle it. And there's nobody in the world that can handle it. Now, I can't tell you not to do it, but I can suggest to you, believe it, you're your brother's keeper. And I know the code of the streets goes for even the squares. You don't want to tell. You know, you don't want to be a rat fink. But you want to know something? You've got to be a rat fink. If you don't want to put your name down, let me tell you something. If I had a friend who was smoking marijuana and I knew it, I wouldn't say, hey, Jake, I'm going to tell on you. I would take his name, take his address, say he's smoking pot, and to use the expression of the streets, I'd drop a dime on him. I'd put a 10-cent stamp in an envelope, put his name and address on it, and drop it in the mailbox. Somebody will take it up from there. But you have to do it. If somebody did it to me, I wouldn't be here talking to you like this. I have a father who's still living. I have a mother who's still living. Do you think this is easy for me? My name is splashed all over the papers. I'll be on TV, national network. Do you think they like it? They don't like it, but they're proud of me now. And with their old European wisdom, they said, well, your name was splashed all over the papers every time you got busted. You know, at least now your nose is clean and you're doing something.
Advertising, I've been asked to discuss the development of your new State Farm musical theme and jingles. It all started with your State Farm emblem that you use in your print and TV advertising, or for your bumper stickers, on your windows, on roadside signs. Leading from this visual logotype of yours, we set out to design an audio logotype that could work with it in a case of television advertising, and yet be a strong enough audio device to stand on its own, for use in radio advertising, for instance. So we started with the idea of having a tuned car horn as a mechanical device to key the design. The horn relates to the automobile, which in turn relates to the bulk of what you sell, auto insurance. And by the very way the instrument would be played, we hope to devise a mnemonic, a memory aid, to recall the name State Farm Insurance every time it would be heard. So we played. You'll notice the plane was syllabic, to conform with the syllables, State Farm Insurance. Just like. Always recall shave and a haircut, two bits, so would this division of a musical phrase say, State Farm Insurance. And yet we needed something else for greater flexibility in the extension of these notes into a fuller musical theme, and then into a complete singable song, which is all important to any good musical lyrical statement of advertising copy. So we got a three-note car horn, and after much experimentation with the lineup of the notes, arrived at this. And these three notes became the basis of all the rest of the music you'll hear on this record. Our current advertising campaign was based on a series of so-called think headlines. Think smart, think cagey, think thrifty. The words smart and cagey and so on were to be variable, and since their syllables could not be predetermined, we elected to have those commands, think smart, think cagey, think whatever, spoken lines, free of any musical restriction. Thereafter, our copy would say, think of saving $10, $20, $30 or more on car insurance for careful drivers, and then, as in song crafting, we revert to the title theme, think, and finish with our logotype, State Farm Insurance. Together with, well, here's how it all goes together.
Think wise. Think of saving $10, $20, $30 or more on car insurance. For careful drivers, think State Farm Insurance.
We formatted the music so that we would have the song in the beginning. Then we would segue into descriptive instrumental music, which you're now hearing, for backing the full copy story, or for backing dramatic situations in which we would act out the full story. And then we come back again with a restatement of the song. We come back to ask for the order.
Think wise, think State Farm Insurance. The careful drivers, careful buyers, car insurance. Call State Farm Insurance.
And this is how I kind of feel. Maybe I'll use the word missionary. If I can make an impression on one, just one of you kids that's here, that's really all I want. Because if somebody somewhere had made an impression on me, maybe, I wouldn't have done it. Now, I was talking at Norland High. And you know what? In an auditorium that had 2,500 seats, in a... Father don't care, and they have to care because they're the ones that have to recognize it. And I know you all talk. Sure, you hear, they're taking dope, their pupils are pinpoints, they're on the knob, they're hanging over there, their nose is down to the floor. That's fine, you're taking morphine and you're taking heroin. But what about the mother who says, I don't believe it, I told my daughter to do the bedroom and she's cleaning the whole house. Isn't this marvelous, she's just abounding with energy. Well, 9 chances out of 10, she's abounding with methadrine. Speed, dizoxin, amphetamine, cocaine, these are exhilarants. And if a mother is looking for pinpointed pupils, she won't find them. She'll find big, black, dilated pupils. But if she doesn't know, what can she do about it? If a kid comes home and says, Mama, I'm sleeping over Jack's house, and Mama calls up and he's not at Jack's house, so what? So he comes home and says, oh, Mom, I said Jack, but I really meant Jim. Well, he's not telling the truth. He was out getting high, stealing a car, laying out on the beach, smoking pot. And to use an old Jewish cliche, from this comes the worst disease. Nobody can get away with it.
You have painted up your lips and rolled and curled your tinted hair. Ruby, are you contemplating going out somewhere? The shadows on the wall tell me the sun is going down. Oh, Ruby, don't take your love to town. For it wasn't me that started that old crazy Asian war, but I was proud to go and do my patriotic chore. And I know, Ruby, that I'm not the man I used to be. But Ruby, I still need your company. It's hard to love a man whose legs are bent and paralyzed. And the wants and the needs of a woman your age, Ruby, I realize. But it won't be long, I've heard them say, until I'm not around. Oh, Ruby, don't take your love to town. She's leaving now, for I just heard the slamming of the door. The way I know, I've heard it slam 100 times before. And if I could move, I'd get my gun and put her in the ground. Oh, Ruby, don't take your love to town. Don't take your love to town.
And you say, I repeat, be a rat fink. How the hell can I be a rat fink? How can I get my friend picked up? Why can't you get your friend picked up for psychiatric help? If you don't get him picked up today, next year he's going to be busted. And you know what? In Florida, for instance, where I am now, it is a mandatory 5-year sentence in the penitentiary for possession of one stick of pot. Now, they say, if you legalize it, that would take away the intrigue, that would take away the cabal, you know, the black market. It isn't so. You know what you have in England? It's legalized there. So you have people standing online waiting for the drugstore to open up. And what do they do there? They open up, they sell them the stuff, and they go into the park, like Washington Park or Gramercy Park, and they sit there in broad daylight, fixing a shot and taking it, and in front of them is 5 little kids, maybe 2, 4, 6, and 8. Mister, what are you doing? So here you're going to grow into a society of kids who have been exposed to mainline narcotic shooting from the time they were able to walk. What can they possibly grow into? All of you people who say, LSD, okay, if you're emotionally stable, you know, it doesn't give you a bad trip. It's a lie. I was thrown from a horse and I had a laminectomy and I ended up in the San Francisco General Hospital. I was operated on by the same doctor who operated on the late Jane Mansfield's son, Zoltan, when he was mauled by the line. Well, while I was there, they brought in a straight B student, 21-year-old, girl from the University of Southern California. She was part Negro, part Spanish, and part Indian. And believe me, she had the beauty of all three. Well, when I saw her, she was in the psychiatric ward. She had taken a trip on LSD, and it was devastating. They committed her to the psychiatric ward on the 6th floor. One of her college buddies came to visit her and bought her a cube of sugar, which had LSD in it, and she decided to escape. Thank you.
not gonna hear no joke. I'm gonna find out before I go. Who's told I'm not gonna hear no joke. Down the hill, I'll throw my knees. By the way, a chicken's teeth. Nothing but the rooster sang his breath. Take his laugh to the hills upstairs.
Looking for love and you want a new life. You want to feel good and you want to be a wife. Play it smart, don't call a man. This is how to do it, you get a plan. Don't see him too much or move in too fast. You have to play it right if you want it to last. You want a ring on your finger and a long white dress. Just do the rules, see him less. Self-esteem, you know what I mean. The truth is there is no in-between. If you want him to really know your essence, stick to the rules and get the lessons.
Do the rules, don't be fools. Just do the rules, do the rules, do the rules. Don't be fools, just do the rules.
Listen, girl, you think you're so smart. You think it's beneath you to play a part. If you chase a man, you could end up alone. You're talking forever, get off that phone. And don't you mess with the married man. You better run away as fast as you can. Remember, you deserve the best. A man of your own who'll pass the test. So don't waste time, 'cause time does fly. Play it cool and you'll marry the guy. And girl, if he don't ask you out, get off your butt and go work out.
Do the rules, don't be fools. Just do the rules, do the rules, do the rules. Don't be fools, just do the rules.
If you want that diamond ring, don't chase the boy, just do your own thing. And if he says he's just not sure, don't let him make you insecure. And if he tells you he needs his space, find someone else to take his place. Don't let a man play with your head. Come on, be smart, stay out of his bed. Put your picture up online. When he finds it, you'll be feeling fine. He emails you, it's the only way. This is how you make him stay.
Do the rules, don't be fools. Just do the rules, do the rules, do the rules. Don't be fools, just do the rules.
If a man's not your to keep. Oh, don't you fret and don't lose sleep. There's plenty of fish in the sea. Believe in yourself, girls. Take it from me. He can be cute and he can be smart, but play it cool or he'll break your heart. If he treats you mean, read the text. Get rid of that man and just say, next! I'm out of here. Do the rules, do the rules. Don't be fools, just do the rules. Do the rules, do the rules. Don't be fools, just do the rules. Do the rules, do the rules. Don't be fools, just do the rules. Do the rules, do the rules. Don't be fools, just do the rules. Do the rules, girls. You'll get what you want.
The avenue of escape she used was to go out the sixth floor window. How was she going to do that? She took one sheet, and even on a king-size bed, I'm sure you all have an idea of the length of a sheet. With that length, she had to tie it to the bedpost, and she lowered herself out the sixth floor. So, of course, she dropped five stories. When I saw her, she was on a striker frame. If any of you remember when Kennedy broke his back, it looks like a long spit. Your head is held immobile by two ice prongs, your feet are tied by traction, and every 2 hours they turn you over. This girl's neck was broken in 6 places. Now, I found out since that they fused her spine and her neck, and she will always be stiff, but it doesn't make any difference because she is a raving maniac and her prognosis is nil. Now, this is LSD. And I know doctors, and I know lawyers, and I know the most stable people in the world that have taken trips on LSD and are still waiting to return. Now, remember that well, please. And you must forgive me. I talk off the top, and if something comes to my mind, I repeat it. Let me repeat something to you that I know every one of you kids will identify with. Damn it, I did this, or damn it, I did that. My older brother was always bugging me. My sister was always bugging me. My mother and father were always telling me what to do. So great. Rebel. By all means, rebel. And start using pills. Start using goofballs. Start using marijuana. Start using horse. And then go to jail. And then you know what? You go into a place like I went to, Rayford, Florida State Penitentiary, where you're thrown into a sardine can, where you eat and you sleep. And you mess on the floor and you lay naked for male and female guards to check up on you. And in the morning, because the smell is ridiculous, they hose you out with a power hose. You're told when to eat, what to eat, how to eat, and what do you eat? Beans and cornbread.
Beans and cornbread. Beans and cornbread. Beans and cornbread.
Beans and cornbread had a fight. Beans knocked cornbread out of sight.
Beans.
Cornbread said, now that's all right.
Beans.
Meet me on the corner tomorrow night. Beans.
I'll be ready. I'll be ready tomorrow night.
Beans.
I'll be ready.
Cornbread, you ain't straight.
Beans.
You better wake up or I'll gas you gay.
Beans.
Been in this pot since 2:30.
Beans.
Swelling and puffing and almost due.
I'll be ready. I'll be ready cornbread tomorrow night. Beans.
That's what beans told cornbread.
Beans.
Always get mad at me.
Beans.
I ain't mad at you.
Cornbread.
I'll be ready tomorrow night.
Beans.
I'll be ready. Grab cornbread by the toe.
Beans.
Beans said, cornbread, let me go.
Beans.
Cornbread said, I'll lay you low.
Beans.
I'm gonna fight you, you so-and-so.
Meet me on the corner. Meet me on the corner tomorrow night.
That's what
Beans
said, cornbread. You're so bad, you always wanna fight.
Meet
me on the corner tomorrow night. And I'm gonna beat the devil out of you. Cornbread said, I'm almost dead.
Beans.
Beans told cornbread, get up, man.
Beans.
You know that we go hand in hand.
Beans and cornbread. Beans and cornbread, hand in hand.
Beans. That's what beans said to cornbread.
Cornbread.
We should stick together,
beans.
Hand in hand.
Hand in hand.
We should hang out together like wieners and sauerkraut. We should stick
cornbread
together like hot dogs and mustard.
Beans and
we should get up
beans
every morning
cornbread.
And don't you?
Yeah!
You should hang out together like hotcakes and molasses.
Hey!
That's what beans say to cornbread. Cause beans and cornbread, they go hand in hand.
Get ready to match the stars. Bill Anderson, Brett Summers, Charles Nelson Reilly, Ava Gabor, Richard Dawson, and Betty White as we play the star-studded Big Money Match Game 77. And now here's the star of the Match Game 77, Gene Reilly.
You want A or B? You want A? Okay, you got A. That's it. All right, my dear. Here we go. The inventor of the bionic woman said, you know how when you buy a car, you get a spare tire?
You do.
Yes. You get a spare tire when you buy a car. He says, well, when I invented the bionic woman, I gave her a spare blink. Oh, we're rolling along. I love these. Oh, this is a terrific one.
Yep.
You know, Betty White has a spare tire and she doesn't even own a car.
Oh, that was mean. I love you.
I only put up with that because she is the Dowager Queen.
Yes.
What did you say?
She says she puts up with you because you're the Dowager Queen. And you sit up there.
Well, you know we're the Dowager Queen. I invented by Gabriel.
Come on, now that's a very good one and a very simple one. Look, Ava's finished already.
That's very bad, though.
Really?
Yeah.
No, don't look.
That's good.
You're not allowed to
speak.
Yes,
I'm allowed to speak. It's my job.
Well, you want to look, look.
All right. Okay, there
you
it
like
is.
It? I'm getting
I love
my
it.
Yeah.
Kathy, are you ready?
Oh, wait a minute.
Oh, dear me.
Oh. I'm sorry, sweetie.
Okay, now. The inventor of the bionic woman said, you know how when you buy a car, you get a spare tire? Well, when I invented the bionic woman, I gave her a spare blank.
Breast and or boob.
Boob. Okay. What do you say, Bill?
I want to say a word about this group in here.
Yeah, say a word about this group.
Let me tell you what, you're a bunch of front runners. Now, if I get the answer right, you're going to say, yay, and a while ago you were booing. I don't like front runners. Well, they're going to boo anyway.
Even though there's a match, they're going to boo, huh?
I said boob tube, is that right?
You give her a spare boob tube.
Bionic, she's got
oh, that's right. Oh, yeah, see? Okay. I get it. Very clever.
Boob tube.
You know, like bionic woman.
I'll explain it later in my dressing room. Yeah.
Now, there's been an error here because, as you can see from the first part of my, I said a pair of.
A pair of.
Now, I got so nervous, you see, because you hurried me along and my little brain wasn't working too well, that I said buns, but I actually meant the other end.
Oh, well, I'm sorry. What it says here is what we have to go with.
Oh, all right.
Okay. Yes.
I'm getting so trashy, I can't stand myself.
Those curls make her look so virginal, too.
Yes.
Fortunately, I'm nearsighted. Now, I said boobaza.
Boob.
And he keeps them, she keeps them in their trunk.
It keeps a spare boob in the trunk, yeah. Okay. Well, he says that when I invented the bionic woman, I gave her a spare boob. What do you say, Ava?
Well, she got two very good ones, so I thought they would have given her a third boobs.
A singular.
Can you see that?
Well, that don't make fun of that. That's the singular.
I speak.
Yes.
A pair of boobs or one bob.
Darling, I speak four languages and I do them all
phonetically. Yes.
You know, mixed up.
And none of them well.
Listen. I gotta save this one. That's right. I'm gonna home say to my wife, Helen, you won't believe this. But watch this. What do you think that means, huh? Buffalo Bob was on the show, you know? Buffalo Boob there. Now listen, I gave her a spare what?
Either way you spell it, boob.
There it is. That's four for you. Now, if you make it five, it'll be an odd number.
You walk like this?
Yes.
No, listen.
Yeah, now be serious,
here.
Betty.
We've
stop
gotta be
this.
Serious. Because
yes.
You won't believe I did start to write that, as you can see by the but I thought it didn't work on the last answer, but I thought maybe head would work on this.
Oh, you didn't.
I know.
Give her a spare head. Okay, there's round one, 4-0 favor the champ, and now round two coming up after this.
In the afternoon, coffee and grits in the morning, and rice and hogshead cheese in the night. Every day, from Monday to Sunday, this is what you get. You have no pride. You have no respect. You're stripped of every vestige of anything that you were given by God. Is that what you want? That's what you'll get. You can't get away with it. Because I repeat, I'm pretty smart, and I couldn't get away with it. And I am trying my darndest to go all over the country. I work for $52 a week in a house for retarded children, because my thing now is I have to help people. I was helped, and I'll tell you how I was helped. I was in the house of detention right here doing a 6-month sentence for being an habitual user. Well, I did my 5 months and I think 20 days, and I was being released the following week. I looked outside, you know, you see 10th Avenue or 6th Avenue in Greenwich, and I said, good God, I have to go out in the street and come up against all these squares, maybe getting a cab or getting a bus or a taxi, and see these damn squares, and I'm not going to be high, I can't do it. So I sent out to my connection, I said, would you please meet me with a shot? I can't make the street scene with the squares, I got to be loaded. I was a good customer, you know, $185 a day habit. So he met me in the rotunda of the house of detention with a shot. I went into the phone booth, and right through my dress, I took that shot. Unfortunately, one of the matrons wanted to make a phone call, and she walked in and busted me. And without ever hitting the street, I was rearrested and got another 6 months as a user.
Thank you.
says, I'm the mother of three adopted girls. I find the men I date are okay when I tell them I have three daughters, but when they find out that they're adopted and from three different countries and not my own biological children, they don't want to date anymore. Whether I tell them up front or after a couple dates, all the men are reacting the same way. They say they could be okay if the girls were, you know, biological children and came with child support. Why are these men reacting this way? Can I answer? Because they're, I was going to say dogs.
Don't you insult my
I'm not going to say dogs, but they are. That's just wrong on every level.
No, it's not wrong.
It is wrong.
I mean, a man doesn't want to take on the United Nations, and this woman's got all these various children and a blended family. I mean, what is it? And you don't know what problems are. I'm serious. I've got a dear friend, adopted some little kid from an orphanage down in Columbia. Child had brain damage. You know, grew up weird. And you just never know what's been done to a child before you get that child. What kind of sexual abuse it's been, what kind of cruelty, what kind of food deprivation, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So you're not a dog because you don't want to take on that responsibility. You don't have to take on somebody else's problems. I mean, you really don't. You can go help people. You could minister to people. We minister to orphans all over the world, thousands of them. We love orphans. We love helping people. But that doesn't necessarily mean that I'm going to take all the orphans around the world into my home. And I think, you know, okay, let's get the next question.
True.
I'm in trouble.
So there I was doing a year without ever hitting the street. Well, I don't say God is dead. I only say that for many, many years we weren't on speaking terms. But this particular day, somebody was up there, and he happened to like me because while I was looking for something else in a magazine, I stumbled on Synanon. And then that man upstairs who liked me finally gave me a little tip and booted me. And I wrote a pathetic letter saying I'm 46 years old, been coming to jail for 18 years, been using stuff for 23 years. Obviously, I need help. Obviously, I can't help myself. Won't you please help me? The lawyer for Synanon came into the house of detention, and February 11th, 1964, when I was released, there are many clinics here. They are all imitations of Synanon. If you kids go in and find out what it's all about, because all the people there have in one way or another identified with me. They can help you. You kids need help. I assume this is your teacher. Don't be afraid. She's only there to help you. Tell her. Get up enough moxie to go and say, I did something, I'm afraid, help me. Jail is not the answer. No prison hospital is the answer.
And now, Reddit question of the week.
Atheism. So here's what's going through my head right now. I've been thinking lately. Now, I don't know if God exists. If you ask, it seems a bit far-fetched, the idea that there is an all-powerful being controlling everything and whatnot. However, on the same token, I also would like to think there's an afterlife. I don't think once we die that there's nothing, just that's it. But I'm questioning the ideas of religions and if there's a God. What do you think? P.S. Please be civil. This is all very new to me.
I think that it took me a long time to realize that, no matter how much I want something to be true, it has no bearing on truth. When we want something to be true, it's really hard to let go of a belief. But some have said that that which we want most to be true should be the most carefully and harshly scrutinized. The truth is, there is no evidence for an afterlife. What we have observed for millennia is probably what is true, that we cease to be. Thanks for listening. To hear more, visit my blog at mondodiablo.wordpress.com. As always, you can see my goings-on at Facebook and Twitter, the former at Hellbound Alleee, the latter at Mondo Diablo. See you all next time.